all cities have this particular residential area. In Detroit, they call it Black Bottom. In Cleveland, they call it Euclid Avenue, 55th, 105th, Central Avenue. In Philadelphia, they call it South Street. In New York City, they call it Harlem. Drop down below the Cotton Curtain, in Atlanta, they call it Buttermilk Bottom. But then you come out west, where it's the best. In San Francisco, they called it the Fillmore District. In Los Angeles, they used to call it Watts. They changed the name, though.
Can be any black Negro ghetto in America. Whenever a brother leaves one city going to another, well, he's really just going from one ghetto to another in that particular city. He's going to the ghetto, and he knows this. That's where his people are. This is where his intentions are, and this is where he knows he's gonna go, because every city has its own tobacco road.
The apartment houses are, there's a lot of apartment houses. There are even housing projects. There are a lot of housing projects. And the majority of the people are state aid or county or what have you. Very few people own anything. You know, there's very little ownership here on houses.
It has a lot of lots, vacant lots, a lot of empty houses, a lot of rundown houses. And the reason why is for, The landlords, the landowners, are the reasons why. It's not the people, it's the people that own the property just don't care enough to keep the property up. When a house gets real run down, it's usually condemned. It is condemned and boarded up, and eventually it's torn down. After it's torn down, it's just a vacant lot. Dirt field, or grass grows, weeds. No one knows who owns the property. The landlords have moved off and just forgotten about it. And it's just there. No one knows who it belongs to. No one cares, really. Whenever white people come down into our community after they have seen a news reel, or if something big is happening down here, like if they just see a magazine on the ghetto, first thing they do is they'll come down here with their cameras, and this would be more like a Disneyland to them, or a Knott's Berry Farm to them. It has a whole lot of railroad tracks. The trains come any hour of the night, anytime they feel like coming. And the community has got so used to seeing the railroad tracks and the trains that they forget they're even there. industry is just run over it. It has a lot of industry, but the profits of the industry do not go into the community. The ghetto has more liquor stores than they have Baptist churches. There's a liquor store on every corner in the ghetto, practically, and the liquor stores inflict the greatest amount of pain to the community. Soul is all through the ghetto. Soul is all through the ghetto. The ghetto itself is sometimes known as Soulville or Soul Town. Whenever I leave the ghetto and I go into Hollywood or some other white town that's around, I feel like I'm out of my world. I feel very lonesome. I feel like I'm the only black person alive. I feel like it's another world. You know, I don't see the things that I'm accustomed to. I don't see the things that, it's just like I'm just a newborn person in another world. But when I'm coming back on the freeway, if I'm on the freeway and I'm coming back to the ghetto, I get off the Santa Monica Freeway and onto the harbor. When I get onto the harbor freeway, my eyes are steady toward the ghetto. I know there's nothing in my mind but home. That's all. There's nothing there but home. And when I feel myself coming back to the ghetto, or when I feel like I'm in the ghetto or I'm on the outskirts of the ghetto, I get a very warm feeling. I feel secure. I feel safe. I feel like I'm wanted again. I feel like I'm back where I belong, back with my people.
Tobacco Road, 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 Road. I'm talking about Tobacco Road.
This broadcast reflects much, but not all, of what it is to be black in many cities in America. The people appearing on this program are residents of South Central Los Angeles.
The Alberto Culver Company, makers of VO5 hairdressing, New Dawn, and other fine products, has relinquished its normal commercial messages to present this program.
A person can be proud to be black. To me, black is a beautiful color. And within this black, you have so many different groovy shades, you know, of brown and tans and what have you.
Black people have finally come about this means of being proud to be black, a feeling of being righteous black. The word black itself has become an upstanding word, and we accept it now. The word black, as of one time we didn't accept black because white America made everything black seem foul, you know, black angels, black lives, everything black to us was, you know, it was taboo, it was no good. But now we have become gained knowledge of ourselves, and black is part of us. This is known as identity, being identified as black. This is the reasons for the naturals and the Afro-American styles that we have picked up and that we have gained knowledge of. This was our customs. And to identify with oneself, he must be known as black. You are black. You are a black man. You are a black woman. You are a black child. Well, that's the trouble with black people. They don't know who they are, you know. And so, but black is all black people. The word black.
To be black is beautiful, I believe. Because we're people that learn to live with hardships that has always been inflicted upon us, and when we see a honky in our neighborhood, it's something that doesn't nobody did, because we didn't been brought up around nothing but black, and this is all we want to be around is black, and when a honky come on the set, it It upsets our set. It's just like if we went out on their set. When we get out there around a bunch of homies, we feel lost, man. We feel like we're the only person in the world. And the minute we get back to the black ghetto, then we feel at home again. We feel like we're king, like we can do what we want to. So black is truly a beautiful feeling, you know. If you appreciate the term black, but if you don't, then you might, you know, if you one of them toms that don't want to be black and want to be somebody else, then you wouldn't have a feeling that I do, and the most of the black brothers do. But black in itself is a beautiful thing to live.
If I could go and come again, I think I would come back as black.
To be black and live in this society is more like looking through a magazine and seeing another world. You know, when you look through a magazine, well, you don't see your world. I mean, you don't see my world. You see another world. You see a world of happiness. You see a world of everything is even, Steven. You know, this is what you see when you look in a magazine. To be black is to, I have to worry about everything. You got to worry about, are you going to be here tomorrow? This is what's happening, you know, and you live from one day to the other. You have to be aware of what's around you all the time, man. You don't trust no white man, and any white man comes up to you, you're going to look at him and check him out very close, see what he's like. It's to be different in dress, man. It's to put soul with everything you do, because soul is part of being black in the ghetto. It's anything you do concerning that white boy, whatever you do concerning that white boy, you got to be twice as good. You got to be twice as good. Whatever you do, whenever you have to confront that white man, you got to be twice as good. If it's going to court, or if it's getting drafted into the army, or whatever's going to happen to you, anywhere in life, you got to be twice as good as that white boy. And you got to show it. And it's a feeling of, you know, of like opening up a book, man, from the beginning to the end, from birth to death. That's what it's like. It's like going through a book, because every day is something, you know, it's something that you know could happen. Anything could happen to you, man. Because, you know, I mean, like, Whitey could just say, okay, anybody who has 60 Chevys, they ain't no good. You got to give them up. You know, he passed a law. There's nothing you can do, man. You know, if he passed a law right now that every black man had to go to a concentration camp, it wouldn't be nothing that could be said. He passed it, you know. If he say all blue chip stamps are no good, throw them away, they're no good. So to be black is to just sit back and just take it easy, man. Easy as it go, that's the way it is, man. You gotta be on your toes all the time. Whenever I look around my room, I see things that I like, things that are part of my world, my bag, the way I believe, you know. And everything up there plays, you know, a part. Everything up there plays a part. Everything you see in my room plays a part of my world. It's what I like and what I like to do and how I believe. And even the clothing or the shoes you happen to see or whatever, if it's just a little piece of paper with a phone number on it, it all is it's my world. When I walk into that room, I walk into another world. When I walk into my room, I walk into what I believe, and I feel very comfortable there. And I feel like I can close my eyes and don't have to look over my shoulder. I don't have any pictures of any particular young lady or anything like that. I have a young lady up, and she's a black woman that was in Playboy, and she's the only black woman Playboy has ever had. I have a picture of me when I was a baby, and the reason I have that picture of me is because I love me. And this is the only thing I write is own, or something that I can write to say is mine, and that's my life. And this is me from the get-go, from the start, me. This is the original me. Soul is it's in us, and we're born with it, and it's something that we respect most highly. We respect soul practically before we respect anything. We respect soul. Soul is the way a person talks, the way a person walks. It can be the way a person carries itself. It can be in everything that a black man does. Soul is respected. And it's more or less something that's high. It's valued very high, and no one is supposed to disrespect soul. Soul is it's more or less a language. It's a way of communicating from one brother to another, because only brothers have soul. White people imitate it. They try to copy it, but it's here. It's here with the black people. And what makes us mad and what really burns us up is when white people don't respect it. See, when white people don't respect it, so we get very angry. This is what makes us most mad, because they don't understand it, for one thing, and they don't even know it exists. To them, it's invisible. It's something that they can't even see. They don't even know it's there, and then they ask questions, why this and why that. If they understood soul, they know the answers to a lot of whys. You feel soul. See, you don't just wake up one morning out of bed and say, you know, wow, I have soul. You don't do that. See, it's just that it's there in you. It's there. It's nothing that, you know, you can control. It's nothing that you just pick up from habit. You don't pick it up from anybody. It's there in you. And it's up to you to develop it, to what extent you ever want to develop it too. Some brothers don't develop it at all. Some brothers just let it lay, and it'll just be there. And some brothers develop it as far as they can. And some brothers will just have soul, and they'll have something to go along with that soul, like sense. And they know how to, you know, to project this soul in the right direction. But soul has, you know, has many, many phases to it. You know, even the women have soul. It's not just confined to the man. And the reason why white people don't have it is because they're just not in that bag, man. They just don't have it. That's all it is to it. They copy it, they imitate it, they try everything they do. Any possible way to get this soul down, they'll try it. They'll try to sing with soul, try to dress with soul, but it's just that, you know, just that way of bottle, man. You can tell it's not for real. It's fake.
Playing, each player puts his whole heart into it, you know. We all express our souls in different ways. One player will go off on a solo by himself, and the rest of us just might back him up. That's where he gets a feeling that he should express his soul to the utmost, you know, for everybody to hear it. And this is one thing that we say, that blacks enjoy more of the crude music than whites, because we put all our soul into it, because this is a way to express ourselves in a way that we might not be able to say it, you know, through speech, but through music we will be able to say it. On the black side of Kungas that lead the group, and they call me the killer, China Red, you know, because I do lead the group and drive hard as I can to make them push and to make the sounds come out a little better.
A person's nickname is a name to get you away from that slave name, is a name to take you away from that name that society calls you. A nickname can be determined by how much soul a person has or how a person carries himself. Say a person smiles all the time, well, you would call him Smiley. Or a person who has large feet would be known as Foot. Or say a person who has a smooth conversation, who always has something to say, well, you would call him the narrator. These are how your nicknames come about. Or then again, they could just come by the name he originally has. Say his last name was Wolf. Well, you probably would call him Wolfman. A fellow who's a fellow who's a very quick thinker, and he's an extremely dark fellow. But he's also easygoing. He's well liked. And say he's always ahead of the rest of the group. Well, you would name him Fast Black. So-called Negroes, whatever you want to call them, their main trouble is that they don't know who they are. See, this is what one of their main troubles are. They don't know who they are. They have been split up into so many different races, and they've been called so many names. The older generation, they don't know who they are. They don't identify with themselves whatsoever, and they are lost. They maybe call a number of things, any name, just about any name except nigger, or maybe in some cases you could call a nigger would be accepted. Colored, it gives me the impression that this white man was just trying to, you know, hang a tag on this man, because when you look at something and you say it's colored, that means it's filled in with something. It's not the original thing, and it's just been filled in like somebody's been drinking chocolate milk or something, you know, colored. The younger generation only accepts one, and that's black. That's identifying with oneself, with one's people. Black people wear naturals to identify with themselves, to be free to wear the hair the way it's supposed to be. This is the way the hair is supposed to be. This is the way a person was born, and this is the way he should die, with his hair natural. He shouldn't die with curls or hot combs in his hair after he's lived his life. His hair has never been natural. His hair has never been original the way it was when he was born. A black baby is born, his hair is not pressed, it's not curled, it's natural, it's like it's supposed to be. And this is the way a person should end his life, with his true identity of knowing who he is.
There has been a time when the so-called Negro was ashamed of the way he looked, and he used every method in the book to try to emulate the whites. They straightened their hair, they processed it, they used various creams, and they did in every possible way to eradicate their original style and his original customs. And it certainly got a certain awareness lately, possibly since the riot in 65 that started somewhere in this vicinity. There's a certain awareness that has come upon the black man, or the Negro, whichever is preferred. I'm proud of the way I look, and I'm going to be who I am regardless. And my hair is my business, and I like the way I look, and we've done everything to beautify it. The natural is a style that is strictly Negroid style, and it's the hair that makes a difference. That's the one thing that we have that other people can't have like. So we're going to justify our cause and be proud of who we are and how we wear our hair and the style, to do everything we can to beautify it. There's several types of naturals. There's excessively long, referred to as the Africanoid natural. There are the Americanized naturals. There's a moderate natural. And the natural in between, the guy wears his hair at any length that he wants, as long as it's kept clean and it's not slicked down or processed. And kept clean and well-groomed. You can wear short natural, even down to a quo vadis style. That's where it's excessively close to show the complete shape of the head. But the main feature about a natural is cleanliness. It radiates a certain desire to want to be clean.
I used to wear my hair pressed and curled, and I wore it that way until I was about 18. And then I began to wear a natural. At the time, I wore natural because to me it was a fad, you know, like the mini dress that came out. And I got tired of the natural and I started to get my hair pressed again. And I wore it for a while and I couldn't style it, I couldn't do anything with it. So I started wearing the natural and I felt myself, you know. Something came out to say I wanted to wear my hair like this. And because this is the way I came in the world. I didn't come in here with it pressed and curled, you know. I came in here with it nappy, just like it is with black, beautiful hair, you know, and I'm black. So I've been wearing a natural now for almost 2 years. And my friends, the ones that wearing the natural, they feel the same way I do or can express themselves a little bit different. But I have a few bourgeois friends that still trying to be somebody else. And what some people call the Caucasian and what some people call the honky, they're still trying to be like those people.
Well, I don't consider myself trying to be like a white woman. I only wear my hair the way I do because that's the style that I like. I'm a Negro and I am proud of it. As far as a white person is concerned, I wouldn't want to be like them because the good Lord made me the way I am, and that's the way I like it. Pressing your hair is just like combing your hair, only the comb is worn. I have been getting my hair pressed and curled for a long time, so I have really gotten used to it. It gives your hair, I think, more body. It takes about 45 minutes to get a shampoo, press, and curl. I go at least twice a month. And I get my hair shampooed and dried, and she press it and curl it and style it. I have a number of friends that wear natural, and on some of them, they do look nice. It all depends on how they keep them up. Personally, I don't like natural. Just like clothes, it all depends on the person and their taste. I pick the style I think is becoming to myself, and what I like, I wear. I don't like naturals, especially on myself.
My mother, she doesn't like it at all. She's a little old-fashioned, you know, she doesn't like it at all. She thinks I should still get my hair pressed. My son, he's wearing a natural now. Because it's something that I should get him, you know, used to in a way, because something to let him know that that's him and nobody else's hairdo is not his. And that's the way I feel about a natural, as myself wearing it, because it's me. It's naturally me, the way it is now.
Negroes have had to do with what they've had so long. Till I think they have, it's just part of their cooking, where they've always had to improvise.
A Pacific soul food dinner. Chitlins, hog maws, black-eyed peas, mustard greens, okra, and cornbread. A very large glass of milk. Dessert. A very large piece of peach cobbler.
And type of food that we, that I was raised on was greens, cornbread, salt pork in the greens, black-eyed peas out of the garden. Well, all the vegetables come out of the garden. And chitlins in the wintertime when they would kill hogs, bag bones, and baked sweet potatoes. That was, as we call it, soul food now. And that was the beginning of my cooking. And as I grew up, I would watch my mother fix various dishes, you know, and I would learn. As far as the recipes is concerned, I didn't know what the recipes was. I just learned through watching my mother, you see.
The greens are grown wild. You have wild greens, you have mustard greens, you have different varieties of greens, and all of these had to be determined, which were good and which ones were not good. Sweet potato pies, rice pudding, peach cobbler, all these things were not even thought of by white people until black people came along and took these things and made delicacies out of them. Say if a slave was in the field and he ran across a field of, say, sweet potatoes, he could he would look at this and he would wonder if he could eat it, because that, after all, he got the leftovers. And when he looked at this sweet potato, he probably would say, well, I could take this home and try to make something out of it. After 400 years of experimenting with a sweet potato, naturally you're going to come out with something, and this is what happened. As far as chitlins are concerned, chitlins were derived way back when we were slaves. And say, for instance, if the white slave master had slaughtered a hog, and maybe he cut the ham and the bacon and all the, you know, the good meat that they ate then off of this hog, and say he threw the guts away of this hog, the guts, that's what they were known as then. And if a slave woman happened to see this garbage laying around, well, she would ask this white slave master for it, and that's what he'd give it to her. And she would take this back to her shack and she would cook it. She would put her touch to it. She would just put that soul in there, and that would make it taste like a delicacy.
You have to be very careful with chitlins when you're cleaning them. You have to clean them. Take very care in cleaning them. Clean them very good. Make sure that all the, you know, they have the tendency to have that hair from the hog on there. Make sure all of that's off. And I wash them and I clean them. I put them in the pot. Salt, pepper, cut an onion up in them. And, well, we always cook by 10 pounds because the whole family come over when we have chitlins.
Well, the older black people, they like stuff like chitlins, hog maws, pig feet, neck bone, hog head, and the pig snoot, and mountain oysters. this is something that the old people like, man. And us younger brothers and sisters, we only dig beef, you know, because the swine ain't doing nothing but it's dead meat, man. You can't even kill a hog, man. You can't poison him, you know. That's the only animal you can't poison in the world. Take the hog from the old people, man, it's just like trying to take the country out of them, man. And that's impossible, you know, because they were mostly raised in the country, man. They wouldn't rebel against anything, you know. They was more or less the hey boy, yes sir kind, you know. we're not that race no more, you know. We are almost a separate race, man, when it comes down to food. another thing. We are in this color and beliefs, some beliefs. But when it comes down to food, to take that hog away from a man, it'd be just like taking their life.
I go to the white neighborhood to do most of my shopping now, because I find out that in the black community, the vegetables, the fruits, and even the canned goods is much different than what they are in the white neighborhood. In the white neighborhood, the vegetables are fresh, crisp, nice. In the black neighborhood, they are dry. They are not fresh. The canned goods are bent.
All soul food is high in our neighborhood because that's why most people buy it. But I don't buy it because I like to save money. I like to know where mine's going. Say, for instance, I buy a pound or two of soul food, say, a batch of chitlin, 10 pounds. And maybe in here they're not real good. And then I don't buy anymore. Once I get bit, I don't buy anything else. I go out of the neighborhood. We get in an old car and we tick-tick way out somewhere where we can find something that's a better quality of food.
Some of the cans in the black community are rusty. You don't find that in the white community. The meats in the black community, the prices are high. The meats are not fresh. And the quality is, they put so much in a package until you're not really able to buy what you want. You have to buy a larger amount in order to even buy the meat in the black community.
Now, for instance, a merchant in this neighborhood will sell a product maybe for a dime or a nickel more in the Negro neighborhood, where in the white community, he'll sell it for a nickel or a dime less. And this, I do know for a fact, is true.
For instance, if there's a piece of furniture and that the low-income family have longed for, and suddenly someone comes along and say, well, now, I'll fix it where you can get it. So you give me 10 blue chip stamp books, and we'll call that the down payment. Well, the average family has 10 blue chip stamp books because he gets stamps everywhere. So he'll just turn in this 10 blue chip stamp books, and then he'll take the next 5 years trying to pay for a $25 piece of furniture. So economically, this is the same situation. I'll see to it, the attitude is I'll see to it that you don't get out of debt. So if I can't get you in the cotton field, I'll get you in the furniture store.
And it's one reason I'll tell you, I say why the white man is a snake in the grass. The white man will train you for any kind of job that he wants you to do. He'll train you for any kind of job that the white woman or man will not do. I don't care what it is that the white person won't do. If the black person don't know how to do it, the white man is willing to train you, no matter how much time, how much money he have to spend to do it, because he know the white man or woman is not going to come in there and do it. But he won't train you for the better jobs. He'll save his better jobs, his best paying jobs, for the white.
Well, I know I've had jobs in different places before I started working where I'm working at now. And I had asked my boss once, I was working in a linen supply, and I asked my manager, could I go in the office? And he said, well, I'll see, you know. So I said, okay, fine. He said, so later on, I asked him again about the job. So he said, well, they didn't have any openings in the office. So this was fine, which I knew was wrong, because that's why I had asked for the job. I knew it was an opening there. So a few days later, here is this old white girl. Her hair is straight. If personally, if I had a business, she couldn't even enter the door if it was left up to me. So she gets the job. So the white man, he feels as though he would rather have a white woman, regardless of what she looks like, whether she's ugly or fat or skinny, whatever. He'd rather have her because she's white than to hire a decent, clean, intelligent Negro girl. I finished high school at the age of 17, and at this time I was qualified, so I thought, for a job in the world. So at this particular time, I had saw the job, and I went down to apply for it. So when I got there, I passed the physical and the written examination. So the guy, after he couldn't find anything wrong with my test, he tells me, he says, well, I don't think that you would enjoy working in this office where they're all white people.
And this experience hit me with such a blow, because at 17, I'm thinking the world is in the palm of my hand, you know. So I don't remember till the day how I left that office. It hit me with just that hard of a blow. I go, and when I do come to my senses, I'm sitting on the bus stop. And the guy on the bus opens the door, and he says, "Lady, what's wrong with you?" It was just that obvious that something had really upset me, you know. So I walk home in a daze after I get off the bus, and when I get here, all I could do was cry. I just cried.
Some of the frustrations of living in the ghetto is the crowdedness, the police, nowhere to go, nothing to do, no jobs, worrying about whether or not you're going to live today for tomorrow.
Like waiting on a bus, man. You be on the bus stop for, you be on the bus stop for about an hour or so, man. And by that time, one of your partners be done came by and you be done got a ride. But the old people, man, they sit there all day trying to wait for a bus.
If you're on a bus stop waiting on a bus, you feel as though it's never going to get there. You keep looking down the street to see if you can just see one iota of the color of that bus to see if it's anywhere in the distance, to count how many blocks it is down. And when you see it, you're hoping it's the right bus.
And over at the red bus, it's just one bus. It'd have to make its rounds around and come back. And if you get there just as it leaves, you have to wait till it makes its all around circle before it'll come back and pick you up.
If you don't have a car, you can't even begin to move. You have to have an automobile before you can even think about getting to a job or getting to find a job or getting anywhere in town. A car is practically mandatory. You have to have transportation. And a fellow will, if his car breaks down on him, he doesn't have any money to put it in the shop or anything. So what he has to do what we call a shade tree mechanic. A shade tree mechanic is a mechanic that doesn't have anything but a pair of pliers, a 9/16 and a screwdriver, and maybe a coat hanger to wire anything up that happens to be loose. A car is something that you can just buy on any used car lot. A car is a common car off the assembly line, but this is not considered as a ride. A ride is something luxurious. Whenever a black man has a ride, he has more or less say just what the word says, a ride. He doesn't have to get up under the hood and mess with the distributor or the carburetor. He doesn't have to do nothing but put gas in it and ride. A ride would be a new car, a 68 Eldorado, a 68 Riviera, or something of that nature. It wouldn't be no junk, and it wouldn't be nothing that was way back. It wouldn't be no more than 2 or 3 years off. It would be something new. All he has to do is get in there and turn the key. And when he goes down the street, he doesn't feel a bump in the road. Everything is smooth, smooth, smooth. The younger generation figures that they ought to be able to put their car the way they want to put it. This is the generation that's more demanding and figures they ought to govern themselves instead of this white society governing them. Their cars are low. They're mostly in the younger generation. They're mostly teenagers, your lowriders. This car is different. This car is different because it's low. And maybe it may have some different color paint job, some flashy paint job. He's distinguished from everybody else. He's noticeable. So he catches a lot of harassment by the police. But the white boys can low ride all day long, all of them down the street, and the police won't say nothing. But when the police comes into the ghetto and sees a low rider, it's always a ticket. It is hard to keep your license because you're watched so closely by the police. And anything that you happen to do, the police is right there looking at it.
This is where most of the laws are broken because on account of economic reasons why they're broken.
they're not broke because the people out in the community want to break them. A guy can't come out and he can't say, I can do this and I can do that. No, he got to think, John crank his car up out there across the street tomorrow morning, it might smoke like hell. It might have one wheel and one wheel off and one wheel on, but John gonna try to go to work in that car anyhow. Then he drives down the corner, and first thing he do, LAPD busted. Why? Because John got one wheel off and one wheel on. But they would stop and think how much money John making. John making $1.25, $1.50, $1.60 an hour. So how can John afford to put a tire on the car? How can John can afford to get a better car?
It's almost impossible to go without getting a ticket in our community because the police harass us so much till they find something. You know, they'll pull us over there, check our brakes. They check our tires. They'll see if we're too low. They'll check our windshield wipers and brake lights, and then they check our dimmer switch to see if our bright lights and things work like that. Any kind of hazard, man, anything they can to give us a ticket.
When a cop stops you, he's gonna check you out for warrants. If there are no warrants, he's gonna come back to your car and he's gonna check out everything on that car. If he can't find anything in that aspect of the car and there's no warrants and there's nothing wrong with you, you're not warned for anything, everything is clean, he's gonna be very upset.
The majority of us brothers do have records, man, because we get picked up on the weekend, we go to jail, and we might have a job, man. And they'll release you anytime they want to on Monday, man. They can release you Monday morning or Monday night. It doesn't make a difference. And when you go back to tell your boss, he asks you where you've been, you know, you got a job to do, you know. And you go back and tell him you've been incarcerated for the weekend, and the first thing you do is wonder why and lay you off. And then the next thing, you know, you don't have a job. You don't have a job, you know, you're not working nowhere. And then you are back on the streets again. You got to do something.
A black man is forever looking over his shoulder because practically anything we do is considered as wrong in the police's point of view. So we have to watch ourselves very carefully. Whenever I see a police car, I get that feeling of defense or self-defense. This is the feeling I get. I feel like that is the enemy. That is the one who inflicts the pain.
Black on Black will continue in a moment. On KNXT Los Angeles. Black on Black is being brought to you by the Alberto Culver Company. The broadcast continues now without commercial interruption.
A lot of people live in the ghetto that are pretty well taken care of financially. Just because they live in the ghetto don't mean that they can't afford nice furniture. Just because they live in the ghetto doesn't mean that they can't drive a nice car. A lot of people, they have homes in these ghettos that they're nice homes. They started from nothing. They've added on, they've put to it, and they built their homes up, and naturally they don't want to leave this. I'm only 24. I bought my home 2 years ago at 22. I have two kids, and my husband, he works, I work, and the majority of my friends are not doing as well as I am because you have to be able to manage in order to have anything, or you have to want something in order to have it. I wanted to have a home, I wanted to have kids, I wanted to have everything that it took to make a life for myself, and I struggled, and I got a husband that wanted the same thing. And this is why we're so far ahead. It takes two to pull, you know. One can't do it by themselves. Personally, I enjoy living in the ghetto. I really do. I enjoy. I would much rather live in the ghetto than live on the hill and look down on the ghetto.
I moved in the project because the house that I was living in was wasn't large enough for my family. So we had to move into the project. I don't live here because I want to, and don't live because I like it. I live in here because I have to. You don't have no privacy in the project. It's no privacy. You just live in a unit. Everybody knows everything the other one do. It's not private at all. I wash, you wash. You move over your clothes off and I'll hang mine up, whether they wet or dry. You can't even sit out on the lawn. Somebody come along and spit where you're sitting. Actually, anything in the project you don't call your own, because the people, the project, they'll knock on the door, and if you don't answer them immediately, they'll take the key and walk right on in. And sometimes I wish I could just move out right now and just, but I know I'll have to stay until I can find something that I can go, but nowadays, everybody's for themselves. As they call it now, it's a dog-eat-dog world. And this don't have to be. I have 13 children, and my husband is the father of all of them. But we have so many others in my neighborhood, all around me, have 9 children, and every child have a different father. One woman have 7. And neither of us have the same father. All of them have a different father. Maybe you have one that the father brings something over to him. Maybe one of the fathers loves his child and he'll come over. And this makes the other children feel left out because the man is coming over. They see, here comes daddy and he's only got a bag for Susie. Why is this, mama? Well, he's not your father. Well, where's my father? Why don't he bring me something? Then it's get out of the house and stop talking to me.
I think it's very rare to have both original parents in the home nowadays in time, because things, just like I say, during that time, things were so hard when I was a kid that most fathers would just desert the mother, or they were having babies so fast and they didn't know how to stop until the father would just get disgusted and just up and leave. That was the only thing he knew to do.
If a man's in the house, she can't get state aid. So this man, he have to go. He leaves voluntarily. It ain't nothing between him and his wife. He leaves voluntarily for ornaments for his kids and for his wife to survive. He leaves and then the state will support him as long as he's not there.
A black man has never really been known to own a family. He's not really an upstanding figure in the home from the get-go, see, because he's, some cheap job paying nothing, in which his wife could go out and make twice as much if she happened to get out there and started working. So we black people have never really owned a family, and this pattern has just been carried on through history. We do have families in South LA with the mother and the father in the home. And a lot of times you probably wouldn't know it because the father has been depressed so bad over a period of time that he's just not even noticed. Maybe he has worked all his life, man. He's tired, you know, and he's just the kind of cat that just, as he's got older, he just lays around, you know, and taking it easy, because life has just did him so wrong. He's went through so much, you know, by him being black. He just went through so much. And when he gets old, man, his mind is just so piled up with this, he doesn't, you know, he's not too good of an image. And he's just there, and nobody even knows he's there half the time.
The black women feel that their black men is not men anymore because they have lost their dignity. You know what I'm talking about? You take a black man, if he can't afford to go down to the store and buy a quart of milk, that makes a man feel like he's not no more man. If a black man come in and his wife feel that he can't go buy her a decent dress. That takes something from that man, just like you or anybody else would feel, same way. But this is what the black people have to contend with. This takes some of the dignity from a man.
I had to help supplement my husband, Sarah. He didn't make enough money for us to get along on. And most of the time, he was out of a job. He was on unemployment. He couldn't get a job. He tried. He would go to various places. And because he didn't have the experience of, the various jobs that they had open, well, the white man wouldn't hire.
During those times that my mother had to work also like to help my father. And times were pretty rough then because my mother would have to leave early in the morning and she didn't come in until late in the evening and my father likewise.
It took quite a deal of away from my children. It left my children alone. I wasn't able to pay a babysitter. My mother, she would come over sometime and look after the children, but she was sick half of the time, so she couldn't afford to come over. So that made me have to leave my children home alone.
She wasn't aware that I needed food to eat at school. I guess I don't know what it was, but anyway, she would leave me a nickel or a dime or something like this. So at lunchtime, I felt embarrassed because at that time in school, everybody had to sit down and eat. And then they would play, or either you ate in the cafeteria, one or the other. So with me not having any food at all, I would sit at the table and the kids would laugh at me. So to prevent this, I would go in the refrigerator and take out the hard butter, then put it on bread and wrap it up and put it in a bag and take it to school. And this at lunchtime I would unwrap and eat.
She would come home in the afternoon, no mother, no father, because we both were still at work. And as she grew up and become a young lady, she began to tell me how she missed me and how much she wanted me at home and how much she wished that I was able to stay home and do the things for her that a parent should do for their children. And that made me feel very bad.
I knew that they were having a hard time. I was always conscious of my mother and my father struggling, you know, in order to have a better life.
If the white man would stop and realize and think that the black man feel the same about his wife as he feel about his, I think it would be a better understanding too. The black man don't want his wife to get up and go to work every morning and punch a time card right along with him. He wants his wife home just like the white man want his wife at home.
Because a father represents the law in the home. And a mother represents love in the home. You take when a child come in and he's hurt or bruised or something, he goes to mama. But when he come in and he has a problem, he goes to daddy, you know, because he figured daddy is the symbol of law. Daddy is a symbol, he comes to daddy because daddy can help him.
And I don't think it's good that a mother have to get out and work and leave her children at home. It makes bad children. Cause some children to go astray. It's too much freedom whereas there's a girl in the home. It causes illegitimate pregnancy in the home from the girl on the girl. And just any number of things that it causes when a parent have to go out and leave her children at home by themselves.
I had quite a few girlfriends while I was going to school in junior high and in high school. Get pregnant and have to drop out of school a few weeks or maybe a month before graduation, or either they get pregnant and don't even go back to school, because once they have a baby, they feel that they're grown. Either they feel that they're grown or they feel that they don't have the time to get back to school and try to learn something.
Many young girls in our neighborhood get caught like that. I think it's because of the lack of understanding with the parents, a lack of security. They can't come to the parents and talk things over with them, and the parents don't take time to talk to them. So I think it's a lack of communication. They don't have a church background, or they don't have anyone to talk to.
Yeah, there were many reasons why girls became pregnant before they graduated, family problems. in the home, or either just getting with the wrong crowd and thinking that crowd was what was happening, and they in turn kept going out with this crowd until somebody would either go to jail or a girl would become pregnant, and whoever the father was, he was still in the crowd, so the crowd moves on. The girl is in turn left there with the child, and her mother then rejecting her because they're saying that she didn't really think.
And it all stems from one minor, which is a factor that shouldn't even be there, and that's unemployment of the father. And this, in turn, brings on all of this other, disease or infection that inhabits the Negro community. This is all just from the white man won't employ the Negro. And all he wants is a decent living, even if it's cleaning floors. He wants just to make an honest dollar, which is awfully hard to do.
Life on the streets for a black individual is entirely different from a white individual, because life on the street in the ghetto is always, it can be very deadly, you know, because certain things you have to be aware of. The main target of life on the street is money. This is the main target of life on the street. This is where your hustling more or less comes in, plays a big part, because you learn how to hustle at a young age, because there isn't too much money in the home. Hustling is a means of support, of making money, of getting what you want. There are no jobs. There ain't no jobs down here at all. So a man has to hustle. If a brother didn't hustle, he'd starve. If a brother's 24 years old and he's married, he has to hustle. If there ain't no job, he got kids, he got bills to be paid, he's trying to make it, and there ain't no job. You know, now what does this white power structure expect him to do, you know? He's got to make some money. That's all there is to it. See, even when you're at a young age, you know, well, you learn how to do different things that'll get you money. It's not just going to a store or stealing or anything like that. That's not a hustle. Hustling can be shooting pool, it can be shooting dice, it can be playing cards, it can be pimping, man. He can hustle radios, he can hustle TVs, he can hustle soda water bottles. A hustle is anything that's gonna bring some money. A hustler must hustle 24 hours a day. There is no rest period in hustle. He sleeps very, very seldom. A pool hall hustler, he's your most common type of hustler. A pool hustler hangs around the pool hall all the time. That's his second home. If one pool hall isn't crowded enough, or he can't get a game in one pool hall, he'll go to the next. But he must keep going until he gets a game. The pimp hustler is his hustle is a 24-hour hustle, 24 hours a day. He's a very clean and neat dressing person, well-groomed, easy-going, gets along with everybody, always has a little money in his pocket. But then you have some pimps who not only pimp women, but they pimp the public, you know. If you gave a man a five dollar bill and ask for change, and he gave you change for a five, you turn around and say, well, I gave you a 10. If he fell for it and said, oh, you gave me a 10? Well, I'm sorry, it's my mistake. This is pimping the public. And when you're hustling, your odds of going to jail are 75 out of 100 when you're hustling. Because most of the time, seeing that we live in this kind of society, everything must be what power structure calls legal. And hustling is not legal, you know, unless you can get a legal hustle. Church is a hustle itself. It's a way of hustling on the people. In fact, it's a damn good hustle, you know? And as a matter of fact, it might even be the biggest hustle of all.
And you find a Baptist minister that's just starting out where anything is served as a church. Let him tell you any place is God's house. Any house is God's house. So a church can be anything, but it just so happens that they went on a main street maybe, or a main street where there once was a store and there isn't a store anymore, where they can lease this building out and it can become a church with a few changes and add a cross to it and put the name up and you have a church.
Let everybody say the Lord.
The Lord
is blessing who?
Is blessing me.
When?
Right now.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody looking so ready today. So exuberant and so exultant. Oh, praise the Lord. I just can't quite get over this after such a short time. Oh, praise the Lord. Let everybody say praise the Lord. One more time, say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
All during the week, we look forward to Sunday. Sunday is an important day in my life. And I stay at church all day long, from 9:30 until around 3, and then come back and go back at 6:30 until around 11. And then I have a full day. Sunday is the only full day I have. I think church has meant an awful lot to me. It's kept me out of trouble. I've never been in jail or never had to be stopped about anything. Just knowing about church and knowing about the Word of God, it's been my whole life since I've been grown. It's meant everything to me. It's been my mother when my mother wasn't around, my father. I think it made me all around see things different than other people.
If I didn't believe in God, and if I wasn't a strong believer in God as I am, I don't think that I could really survive down here on earth with the conditions like they are. And the main thing is living and getting along with the white man. It's a problem here. You have to really be a believer. You have to pray. You have to ask God for your strength, your courage, and everything to get along with the white man. Because if it wasn't for God, I don't think I could survive.
We thank God for these young people. Because as you know, there are so many other places they could be. And so many other things they could be doing. But they chose to be in the house of the Lord today. And truly we thank God for them.
Lord, in blessing me right now.
Well, church meant to my family that I brought all of my children up in the church. And it's meant a lot to them. I've never had one to go to jail. I've never had one in juvenile. I think knowing what it is and being taught the right way have kept them out of anything they know. If anything anybody tell them, they already know it because I've taught it to them and then had the teachings of the church behind me.
I do believe in God. In fact, I know there is a God. I was raised in the church from a child on up. In fact, I had to go where else as a kid. And this has helped me tremendously in my grown-up days. And it also helped me to understand that the white man, because if without the church, I don't think I'd be able to sit and understand his ways and understand his actions.
Everybody is standing. When I was little, my mother sent me to church. You know, I went to church too. She would dress me up. I even had a suit that I just wore to church. You know, this was church. Sunday was a sacred day. Nothing else to do on Sunday but go to church. Well, church to me was I didn't like it. I didn't like sitting up in that hot room for hours listening to what this fella had to say, who was jiving all the time. And I knew he was jiving. And as I got older, I had big ideas. I saw through this fella up there, and you know, now I believe in myself. I believe if anything is gonna be accomplished, it's gonna be myself. I could sit down and pray all night for a job. I can sit down and pray all night for anything that I happen to want. And praying ain't gonna get you nothing. It ain't gonna bring you nothing. When you look up on the walls in the church, well, what you see is this white man. You don't see anybody that identifies with black people. This man has blue eyes, he has blonde hair, he is the white man. This is what you see. And this is the way America has made it. You know, this is the way America has made their God to be. Like them, you know, like white people. But this is white people's God. So naturally, you're supposed to identify with them.
I don't need Jesus, because Jesus hasn't done anything for me. If he had done something for me, he would have created us all equal. He would have put our people where we wouldn't have to be struggling for something all the time and begging and asking for somebody to give us something. If it was a Jesus, how come he didn't make everybody one color? How come you got our people begging? How come you got our people, had our people in slavery for most of the time? See, that's why I believe that it's no Jesus. It's no Jesus. Jesus is just something that the white man led the black man to believe in. And now that the black people are now aggressing the way they are, they know who they are, and they all know that they are God. And I think that I am God. In fact, I know I'm God, because God is somebody that can do what he wants to do, and I'm going to do what I want to do.
As far as God is concerned, God can be you. God, I feel as though God is me. If anybody's gonna do anything, it's gonna be me. God ain't gonna do nothing, you know. Even at a time of death, if it's time for you to die, man, you're gonna die, you know. It ain't no ifs, ands, or buts about it. If it's your turn, you're going. If any bad luck hits you, it's just bad luck. It's no, you know, like you committed a sin, so and so is gonna happen. It's no, I don't believe it's any of that. I believe if anything's gonna happen, it's gonna happen. And God, man, this is a way, you know, it seems like to me it's a way of scaring the people. You know, if you tell somebody, you know, well, look here, you do wrong, you're gonna die, you're gonna burn forever, you know, this cat gonna think, I don't wanna burn forever, you know, he's gonna believe in this God, man. It's, you know, it's a way of just taking a person's mind, man, and doing things to it, you know. And I just don't believe in no God. I think if anything's going to happen, if any wheels are going to turn, or if I'm going to move up in a position in life, I'm going to do it myself. And when I die, I'm dead.
Rebuke that cancer. Rebuke that tumor down. In the name of Jesus. Rebuke that tuberculosis. Everywhere. Send your word to heal. Let your glory be revealed. Your wonders manifested. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen. Amen.
You know, a child reaches an age when he starts asking a lot of questions. And I got at that age, instead of me asking questions about why was there air, I got to wondering why was my surroundings so different? Why did I only see white kids on TV? I come with no black kids on TV, you know. Why was, you know, the white guys always a good guy? I never could figure that out. I always wondered why did television always make a fool out of other races? And why was the white man always looked upon as top dog? Why was he always the one that no one could criticize or no one could touch? He was always the supreme being in the image of television or in the magazine or wherever else he happened to appear. He was always the king, the top man. And when I was little, the only white man that I ever saw that ever came to my house was either the insurance man or the police. A white man never came to my house just to come. He either came to collect some money
or to take somebody to jail. And this is what molded my mind in the way I believe today.
Black people feel very harsh about white people. They are not liked by us. And they just, you know, they don't rank too high. And whenever we see one, we watch him. We always watch the white man. Forever. Because this is the man who is a threat to us. This is the man who wants to enslave the world, practically, if he thought he could. And whenever we see him or whenever we come in contact with him, we try to be twice as good, because this is what it's going to take. We got to be twice as good, see, because we know him, but he doesn't know us. We know him very well. We know how to identify him. We know how to think in the way he would think and how he feels about us. We know this, see, so whenever we see one, we kind of be on guard. There's no great love for him, and there is no sympathy for him and nothing. He's the devil, and that's it, the evil one.
You know, when I see a white person, a white man or a white woman, the first thing I start thinking, what do that person, that white person, want from me? Because I feel in the back of my mind that they don't mean me any good. They never have meant me any good. So why should I believe that they mean me any good now? There have been times that I wouldn't let a white person in my home, and it hadn't been too very long ago. Because a white man is a funny thing. He'll laugh and talk with you today, this minute. And the next thing you know, he've cut your throat. And I don't mean with a knife. I mean with words, with anything he can hurt you with. But he'll make you think that he's your friend. And that all the while, he's making you, trying to make you believe that he's your friend. He's the worst enemy you could have.
We done took so much from the white man until now that we feel that it's got to be a change. So we always had to be on the end of asking. So now we're going to take if we can't get. We didn't ask long enough. My generation is fed up with it. I mean, what good is it to be a man if you got to beg for something? You know, if you're a man, you're supposed to go out and get it. And so I feel that we'll go out and get it. If we have to fight to do it, we're going to do it. And if it takes giving up my life for my people, I'll do it. Because we don't have anything to lose from the get-go. We black, we ain't never had nothing, and never will have nothing. So if it calls for my life, then I'm willing to give it up.
It's time for the black man to try and better their condition and show the white man that they are it's just as much as the white man, and that they can get as far as the white man if given the opportunity, but not in a violent way.
We had to burn our own houses, our own storefronts. We had to burn down our own neighborhood, in other words, to get the white people, the majority of the white power structure, to pay attention to what we was after. All right, we got some attention. I agree, we got some attention. But the next time, it's going to be the white people that's going to be burnt down.
This riot and things is not necessary. It don't have to be. I don't know what the answer is as yet, but I know this rioting and burning and stealing and looting is not the answer.
The reason why things would be done through bloodshed is because this seems to be the only thing that makes the power structure move, is violence. The youth knows that they will die. They are aware of this. As a matter of fact, they are expected to die first because they are the warriors. America teaches you not to be violent, but America, the very foundation of America, is built on violence. America has had violence all as long as it has existed. They have been in some kind of violence. Violence was the birth of the country. The rockets red glare, the bombs bursting in air.
We are Americans, we love America, we are part of America, and we want to be a part of America. And the idea of it is, that's our fight, to be a part of America.
if things don't change, we'll have to make them change through force. And this is the belief that black people have, the younger generation has. It's not going to be anything where this is the good white boy and this is the bad white boy. It's going to be more or less white against black. No ifs, ands, and buts about it.
This broadcast has reflected much, but not all, of what it is to be black in many cities in America. The people appearing are residents of South Central Los Angeles. The Alberto Culver Company, makers of VO5 hairdressing, New Dawn, and other fine products, has relinquished its normal commercial messages to present this program.